Ooh, which one is that? Probably a mockingbird. Well, hello there again. It's Green Deane, and welcome to my 81st video here on EatTheWeeds.com. Yeah. No, you know, I think that's a cardinal. It's not my area of expertise. Anyways, today we're going to look at a plant that should be in your garden, and you can grow it there, but you're going to find it next to the seashore. Don't think I'm going to need a magnifying glass for this, perhaps. This is sea purslane, and it looks just like the purslane, or very similar to the purslane you find in your lawn, except it's just a heck of a lot bigger. Let's see here. Get a look at this. There's some big purslane. Big purslane. Scientifically, well, this is a tough one, this is called Cessusium portocalclastrum. It's named after some tribe that Caesar-like, but no one knows why it was named after it, and that also it's named after the purslane you find in your gardens. Let's pick up this piece here, good size. Now, the Indians use this quite a lot. You can eat this raw or cooked. You can steam it, or you can boil it to reduce the salt content. And they used to pickle and eat the stems. And you find this, as far north. Found it around the world, but in North America, you find it as far north as Pennsylvania, of all places. There was some reported there in 1865, and presumably it's still there now. But sea purslane. So I wanted you to get a look at it before we go out on the beach, and find some. This is the time of year to find it. And of course, let's take a look at an individual leaf here. You just put that there, so you can see. Very succulent. See? Very thick. Of course, this happens to be sandy, but that's all right. Wash it off. Into the salads it goes, in the stew pot it goes, and of course, you can use it, wash it and chop it as it is, and use it for a salty flavoring. Well, this is one of those rare days when there's very, very little surf out here, and that's good because the plant we want to look at is over there. Well, as you can tell, I'm on the beach today. Good reason, because the plant we want to look at grows here. Sea purslane. Look at this. And it looks like the purslane that you find in your garden store and all that, except it's on steroids. Another way you can tell, I'm sure you can see in this little picture here, is we've got a kind of five-petaled little pink blossom that only lasts a day, and then it goes away. It has large stems, very fleshy, very, very much reminiscent of the plant you see in your garden. So let's see if we can find a stem here. Look at the big size of this stem. Very succulent. And of course, like the other plants of the seaside, you can do with this. You can eat it raw. If it's too salty, you can boil it in one or two changes of water. And or you can just chop it up and use it as a vegetable seasoning for your salad or something like that, or your soups and stews. Very, very nice. Sea purslane. And actually there's several blossoms coming out here. A lot of food sitting here. So the issue is, you know, when you go to the beach, there are a lot of plants. Now, where does it grow? Why does it grow here? Well, it likes salt. It can tolerate salt. And it's just above the rack line. The rack line is where the seaweed comes up and stops, and then this area right here is between high tides and the dunes, and this is where these plants come in. What happens, these plants collect the wind with a bit of sand in them, the sand drops and the sand builds up, and that allows for the dune to build up and for other plants to come in a little higher up, and that's how the dune is built. You know, it's built just like this. Pioneering plants that can tolerate salt come in, grow here, and they're very fleshy, so they save liquid when it does rain. The wind hits it, drops the sand, builds the sand up and more, and that's how the entire thing grows. And eating a little bit won't hurt, picked up. Is notice how much red this is. You'll find that too among your sea vegetables. They often turn red as they progress through the season. So this is usually, as we just saw, a very green plant, but you can also see it's getting on tinges of red and pink. Very, very common for salt tolerant plants to take on a red hue. Like some of these over here are quite pink. Sea purslane is quite good when you cook it up. Quite tasty. You wouldn't think so because it's got some pretty stiff stems, but they soften up quite nicely. The only thing you have to do is you have to make sure that the old leaves that are shriveled up are taken off first before you cook it. But when you're done, it's very nice potherb. If you take a piece of sea purslane home with you that has a joint in it, and you put it in water in the shade, it will sprout. And then you can put it in a pot or put it in your gardens, and you can have sea purslane even though you may not be anywhere near the sea. Also, there are at least two local species of sea purslane, and they're actually found around the entire world. So even though I'm talking about Florida and North America, you can actually find sea purslane, edible purslane, just about any location on the rotation. Here in Eat the Weeds, we itemize. Let's start out with identification. Well, you know, it really does look like garden purslane on steroids. It's just got heft. It's just a lot bigger. You know, it's low growing and no, very prostrate. Very low growing. It's very like a mat. Doesn't branch too much. Its leaves are opposite. They're smooth and very fleshy, and they're spatular shaped to oblong, and they can be a half inch to 2 inches long. The fruit capsule, the fruit is actually a capsule, and it has a lot of little black seeds in them, and they're edible also. You can make a mush out of them and stuff like that. Time of year, well, spring to fall. Now, if you're in a warmer climate, you can extend that a bit, and if you're in a colder climate, you've got to contract that a bit. The only caveat that comes with is that as the plant grows older, it becomes more fibrous. So you always want to kind of collect from the new growths on the end. The further back you go, the more fiber you get. Now, you can still cook them and chew the goodness off them, but you end up with a big ball of fiber. And I know from personal experience that it can irritate your tummy, so don't eat the fiber. Environment. You know, it likes just above the high tide mark. You know, just like many of the plants there, it's a dune-building plant, and that's where it likes to grow, and that's where you find it, or in damp soil near the ocean also. Method of preparation. Well, there's quite a few. Let's see. You've got stems and leaves raw or cooked or pickled. And depending upon the saltiness, it may not need to be cooked at all, or only cooked once, or boiled twice, or boiled three times, or in several changes of the water. It varies quite a lot. I want to thank you for joining me here on my 81st video on EatTheWeeds.com. If you want to know more about sea purslane, of course you can go to Eat the Weeds and read about that. It's one of those plants that I enjoy very much, and because, you know, whenever I'm out on the beach, by gosh, there it is, and it always says, take me home. But of course, I never collect it in a national park where that's illegal. No. I only get it from places where nobody cares. So until next time, this is Green Deane. I want you to think green, I want you to eat green, I want you to live green, and that includes eating some green stuff from the sea, close to the sea purslane. Toodles.